Listening Library presents The Westing Game by Ellen Raskin. Read for you by Cassandra Campbell. For Jenny, who asked for a puzzle mystery, and Susan Kay. Chapter 1. Sunset Towers. The sun sets in the west. Just about everyone knows that. But Sunset Towers faced east. Strange. Sunset Towers faced east and had no towers. This glittery, glassy apartment house stood alone on the Lake Michigan shore, 5 stories high. 5 empty stories high. Then, one day, it happened to be the 4th of July, a most uncommon-looking delivery boy rode around town slipping letters under the doors of the chosen tenants-to-be. The letters were signed Barney Northrop. The delivery boy was 62 years old, and there was no such person as Barney Northrop. Dear Lucky One, here it is, the apartment you've always dreamed of at a rent you can afford in the newest, most luxurious building on Lake Michigan, Sunset Towers. Picture windows in every room, uniformed doorman, maid service, central air conditioning, high-speed elevator, exclusive neighborhood near excellent schools, etc., etc. You have to see it to believe it. But these unbelievably elegant apartments will be shown by appointment only. So hurry, there are only a few left. Call me now at 276-7474 for this once-in-a-lifetime offer. Your servant, Barney Northrop. P.S. I am also renting ideal space for doctor's office in lobby, coffee shop with entrance from parking lot, high-class restaurant on entire top floor. 6 letters were delivered, just 6. 6 appointments were made, and one by one, family by family, talk, 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 Barney Northrop led the tours around and about Sunset Towers. "Take a look at all that glass. One-way glass," Barney Northrop said. "You can see out, nobody can see in." Looking up, the Wexlers, the first appointment of the day, were blinded by the blast of morning sun that flashed off the face of the building. "See those chandeliers? Crystal," Barney Northrop said, slicking his black mustache and straightening his hand-painted tie in the lobby's mirrored wall. "How about this carpeting? 3 inches thick.
"Gorgeous," Mrs. Wexler replied, clutching her husband's arm as her high heels wobbled in the deep plush pile.
She, too, managed an approving glance in the mirror before the elevator door opened.
"You're really in luck," Barney Northrop said. "There's only 1 apartment left, but you'll love it. It was meant for you."
He flung open the door to 3D.
"Now, is that breathtaking or is that breathtaking?"
Mrs. Wexler gasped. It was breathtaking, all right. 2 walls of the living room were floor-to-ceiling glass. Following Barney Northrop's lead, she oohed and awed her joyous way through the entire apartment. Her trailing husband was less enthusiastic.
"What's this, a bedroom or a closet?"
Jake Wexler asked, peering into the last room.
"It's a bedroom, of course," his wife replied.
"It looks like a closet."
"Oh, Jake, this apartment is perfect for us, just perfect,"
Grace Wexler argued in a whining coo. The third bedroom was a trifle small, but it would do just fine for Turtle.
"And think what it means having your office in the lobby, Jake. No more driving to and from work, no more mowing the lawn or shoveling snow."
"Let me remind you," Barney Northrop said, "the rent here is cheaper than what your old house costs in upkeep."
How would he know that?
Jake wondered. Grace stood before the front window, where, beyond the road, beyond the trees, Lake Michigan lay calm and glistening. A lake view! Just wait until those so-called friends of hers with their classy houses see this place. The furniture would have to be reupholstered. No, she'd buy new furniture. Beige velvet. And she'd have stationery made, blue, with a decal edge, her name and fancy address in swirling type across the top. Grace Windsor Wexler, Sunset Towers on the Lake Shore. Not every tenant-to-be was quite as overjoyed as Grace Windsor Wexler. Arriving in the late afternoon, Seidel Pulaski looked up and saw only the dim, warped reflections of treetops and drifting clouds in the glass face of Sunset Towers.
"You're really in luck," Barney Northrup said for the sixth and last time. "There's only one apartment left, but you'll love it. It was meant for you."
He flung open the door to a one-bedroom apartment in the rear.
"Now, is that breathtaking or is that breathtaking?"
"Not especially," Seidel Pulaski replied as she blinked into the rays of the summer sun setting behind the parking lot. She had waited all these years for a place of her own, and here it was, in an elegant building where rich people lived. But she wanted a lake view.
"The front apartments are taken," Barney Northrup said. "Besides, the rent's too steep for a secretary's salary. Believe me, you get the same luxuries here at a third of the price."
At least the view from the side window was pleasant. "Are you sure nobody can see in?" Seidel Pulaski asked.
"Absolutely," Barney Northrup said, following her suspicious stare to the mansion on the North Cliff. "That's just the old Westing house up there. It hasn't been lived in for 15 years.
"Well, I'll have to think it over."
"I have 20 people begging for this apartment," Barney Northrup said, lying through his buck teeth. "Take it or leave it."
"I'll take it." Whoever, whatever else he was, Barney Northrup was a good salesman. In one day, he had rented all of Sunset Towers to the people whose names were already printed on the mailboxes in an alcove off the lobby. Office, Dr. Wexler. Lobby, Theodorakis Coffee Shop. 2C, F. Bombach. 2D, Theodorakis. 3C, S. Pulaski. 3D, Wexler. 4C, Hu. 4D, J.J. Ford. 5, Shinhu's Restaurant. Who were these people, these specially selected tenants?
They were mothers and fathers and children. A dressmaker, a secretary, an inventor, a doctor, a judge. And, oh yes, one was a bookie, one was a burglar, one was a bomber, and one was a mistake. Barney Northrup had rented one of the apartments to the wrong person.
Chapter 2. Ghosts or Worse. On September 1st, the chosen ones, and the mistake, moved in. A wire fence had been erected along the north side of the building. On it, a sign warned, "No trespassing. Property of the Westing Estate." The newly paved driveway curved sharply and doubled back on itself rather than breach the city-county line. Sunset Towers stood at the far edge of town. On September 2nd, Shinhu's Restaurant, specializing in authentic Chinese cuisine, held its grand opening. Only 3 people came. It was indeed an exclusive neighborhood. Too exclusive for Mr. Hu. However, the less expensive coffee shop that opened on the parking lot was kept busy serving breakfast, lunch, and dinner to tenants ordering up and to workers from nearby Westing Town.
Sunset Towers was a quiet, well-run building, and except for the grumbling Mr. Who, the people who lived there seemed content. Neighbor greeted neighbor with good morning or good evening, or a friendly smile, and grappled with small problems behind closed doors. The big problems were yet to come. Now it was the end of October. A cold, raw wind whipped dead leaves about the ankles of the four people grouped in the Sunset Tower's driveway. But not one of them shivered. Not yet. The stocky, broad-shouldered man in the doorman's uniform, standing with feet spread, fists on hips, was Sandy McSouthers. The two slim, trim high school seniors, shielding their eyes against the stinging chill, were Theo Theodorakis and Doug Who. The small, wiry man pointing to the house on the hill was Otis Amber, the 62-year-old delivery boy. They faced north, gaping like statues cast in the moment of discovery.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.